Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide, you don't need a TV.
Greetings, everybody. It is Ken Reed here. I had to think about it for a second. Who am I, really? It is time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor, the weekly podcast in which we discuss the television we all watched growing up, pre-millennium, sometimes post-millennium too, depending on who the guest is. My guest this week is artist Bob McLeod and children's author, actually. Bob started at Marvel Comics in the 1970s and has a fascinating story of what it was like to work there back then and worked at DC. He was one of the co-creators of The New Mutants, which is my favorite X book, probably followed by Excalibur. We do talk about the movie a little bit here, whatever the fate of that thing is. As you know, I'm a huge comic book fan. I discuss it often on the show, and really I would love to do a podcast about Bronze Age comics. I'm sure there are a zillion of them out there from people far smarter and far more entertaining than I am, but that would be a lot of fun if I could come up with an interesting angle on that. But Bob was in town doing a convention and was nice enough to sit down and talk to me about comic books and art and how he got his start and the things he watched and westerns and all those things. I do unfortunately have to apologize for the audio here. I bought a new recorder, and these mics that I use are high-quality mics that have magnets in them and require a thing called phantom power. And the power failed on Bob's mic, so his vocals, we weren't singing, but his voice was only picked up by my microphone. The dogs are very angry at me. I do feel terrible about that. But is still listenable because he has such great content. I did not want to not put this episode out. And I apologize to Bob that this is not the crisp, clear sound that I am normally up to with my standard. But as I said, his content was amazing, and so I futzed with the audio best I could to make it as listenable as possible, and I think it still is. But I wanted to give you that warning. I know some people are very audiophiles. That's the word I wanted to listen to. So I wanted to give you a warning. It's almost like a spoiler alert. But yeah. So that's Bob. This is my chat. Please sit back, relax, and enjoy my chat with comic book artist Bob McLeod.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Bob McLeod, how are you, sir?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Thank you so much. Thanks for taking the time after no doubt a very long weekend for you, I imagine.
I'm surprised how exhausting these shows are. I mean, I'm just sitting there and, you know, sketching. I do a lot of sketching, but I'm just so worn out at the end of the day.
It's sort of, I don't want to say emotionally taxing, but it's just, you have to be on for basically 3 days.
Right.
And that's, yeah, that's a lot. And I'm, you know, you're glad to be there, but it's tough, you know. How many sketches do you think that you probably do in a weekend? I know it's kind of an annoying question.
I did a bunch. Sometimes I do about 10 a day. This one, I think I probably did fewer than that per day. But I would say 8 to 10 a day.
That's a pretty good amount. I mean, that's
1 hour.
That's pumping them out. I mean, that's.
I don't do sketchy little quick draw sketches. I try to do pretty much finished drawings in ink. And everybody's always talking about how clean and precise my drawings are. But, I mean, they're still sketchy.
Yeah. But your stuff's always been kind of that way. It's very. Because, how long would it take to ink a page?
It really varied a lot depending on the page. I could, one time I inked 4 Gene Colan pages in a day. But with Gene, you know, you're not trying to fix up his drawing because his drawing was so unique. Once you start trying to mess with it, you totally ruin everything that makes it great. So he was, I thought, easy to ink. And then somebody that wasn't a good figure artist, which I got a lot of those early on because they knew I could draw,
right,
help them, and so they expected me to kind of pull their drawing together, and so that takes longer when you're trying to do brief drawing.
You're basically drawing it. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and we were talking about TV a little bit before, but before we dig into that, one of the things that I wanted to talk to you about too is I think it was maybe one of your first professional drawing gigs was for Crazy.
Sure, my very first.
Was that your very first?
Yeah.
And that did, you know, for people that don't know, I guess Marvel, was it a Curtis magazine? Did Marvel do Crazy?
I think it was.
And it was sort of their version of Mad Magazine. Early 70s?
Yeah. Well, I started in 74.
Okay.
So that was the first job of mine, the satire of Westworld for Crazy, was 74, I believe.
Prescient now, given how popular Westworld the TV show is.
All new to me.
Yeah. I mean, how hard is it to do, you know, parody stuff where you're drawing, you know, specific actors, and people take for granted how easy it is to pull up a reference piece now.
Actually, for that, they paid for the writer, Mark Wolfman, and myself to go watch the movie, and then they gave me these glossy photos to draw from.
Oh, wow.
Like a big shot.
Yeah.
I've made it to the big time here. So I had a lot of reference for that. But a lot of times in satires I did after that, not so much. So I would look at whatever photos I could find of them, and then I would also look at Mort Drucker.
Yes. I mean, Mort Drucker was like picture perfect for a lot of that stuff. Yeah.
Basically wanted to be Mort Drucker when I was growing up.
I was kind of a cracked guy, but mostly because in the 80s they had hired all the great mad guys. Yeah, Severin and Mort Drucker and all those guys. And so I was like, oh, this is like mad in the 70s. And a lot of underground comic. Daniel Klaus was drawing for them and all kinds of weird stuff. But yeah, I mean, they capture that stuff perfectly. And one of the things we talk about on the show a lot is how, you know, because it was pre-VCR, and a lot of us couldn't rewatch TV shows, a lot of us knew about TV shows or rewatched our favorite shows by reading like the Mad Magazine parody.
Yeah, when they would do a parody, it was like a movie.
Yeah, because how else are you going to see it unless it comes on TV? So, I always wonder how much of memory you had to draw from. Was there anything you had to draw that was from like when you were a kid? Like we were talking about, you watched a lot of Westerns, but I don't think you did. You do any Western comics?
I did not. On gaps in my career, I was never able to get a Western. I inked one little 10-page backup by Rich Butler, Western. That might be it. Always wanted to do a Western. I always wanted to do a romance comic.
Yeah.
Never did one of those. Superheroes kind of started just taking over the industry about the time that I came into the business. And especially, I started as an inker, so once I got my penciling up to snuff, which took me like 5 years after that crazy job.
Yeah.
It had even more so taken over the industry.
So you grew up in Florida, and how do you get from Florida to New York working at, was it Marvel? You're an editor? Was that the first thing you did?
I was actually scuba diving.
Okay.
I was scuba diving in Florida and trying to impress this girl. And I said, I'm going to be an artist. And she said, when are you going to get started?
As soon as we're done with this. Yeah.
Well, it's time. So I sold my car to finance a trip up to New York, because at the time you had to pretty much be in New York. All the publishers were there. This was pre-internet, and had to be there to get the work. So sold my car and went up to New York and showed my samples and got rejected. Joe Orlando was the art director at DC Comics and said, you need to go back to school and learn how to draw.
And I said, that's like the most devastating possible, yeah.
Yeah, because I'd already been to art school for a year.
Oh, God.
And college, I majored in art for a year. And I had quit both of those because they weren't teaching cartooning or many of the fundamentals. They were trying to teach you to be a fine artist and express yourself. And I didn't want to do that.
Yeah.
I wanted to draw cards, some kind of comics or cartoons or something. I actually did not intend to work for Marvel for very long. I was going to use it as a stepping stone and move on to Mad or move on to my own comic strip or Disney or who knows what. But then when I got rejected, it's like, well, I'm going to show these guys to do this.
Spite is such a great motivator.
Just worked real hard. And started off in the production department at Marvel. My first job was actually taping the page numbers onto the pages.
Because someone had to do that.
It was called Paste Up and Mechanicals. So I was doing letter corrections and worked my way up to art corrections. And after about 6 months, started getting freelance work.
So you're in Florida. Whereabouts in Florida was it?
Tampa.
Okay. This was in the 60s. They were shooting Flipper. But I think there was was that in Orlando that maybe they shot it? And they were shooting like random things down there all throughout the 60s and 70s. But it probably felt a million miles away from New York City, I imagine.
Well, yeah. I was scared to death when I went up to New York. You know, from living in Florida, we thought of New York as murderers and you know, thugs and people getting knifed on the subway.
Kind of was in the 70s. It was just the Warriors, basically.
Yeah, so I flew into LaGuardia, which is in Queens, and it took me days to build up my courage to actually go into Manhattan. So I was just sitting in my... I got a room at the YMCA because it was really cheap there, and was doing sample pages, and finally just said, well, I'm going to become an artist or die.
Yeah.
And of course, I was fine.
Yeah.
Walked all over the town. I loved Manhattan.
Were there any shows you watched as a kid that were set in New York? Because, like, I think of the 50s and 60s New York stuff, and there's sort of that weird intellectual game show thing, like, you know, What's My Line and To Tell the Truth. Those are all very New York to me. But
I used to watch those game shows.
That sort of, you know, New York sort of aristocracy stuff. But then it was just crime shows, I guess, and cop shows.
Well, Dragnet?
Dragnet was L.A.
Okay. What else did I watch? Cop shows.
I love Dragnet, by the way.
I don't know. I have to think about that a while, but if it was a TV show, a crime show in the 60s, I watched it.
Yeah, we had like Streets of San Francisco was like 68.
Yep. Sure.
I'm trying to think of Michael Douglas. I'm trying to think of what New York
later
shows would
on,
it be.
What's the one that starts with an M?
Mannix?
Mannix.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, Mannix was great. I think Kojack might have been New York.
Mannix is 70s?
Mannix was 70s, early 70s, I think. Yeah. Banachek. Those around the time. But you.
Kojack
was a classic. I think the Beastie Boys, the band, coined this phrase, but they always say whenever you pull up somewhere and get a space right out front, that's the Kojack spot. Because
okay.
He never had to look for parking. It was always perfect spot right up front. Yeah. Like, what luck. Perfect Kojack spot. So it sounds like you were watching a lot of cartoons and stuff down there too. Like Saturday mornings were everything to a kid.
Oh yeah, couldn't wait to get up Saturday morning and watch TV.
Was there a favorite that you had?
Favorite? I don't know. I liked everything. I mean, I really did. I was really into all the animation, even the live action kid shows. We had a local TV show, Mary Eleanor something, where she would do drawings from your initials.
Oh, yeah.
Turn those into drawings.
Yeah. It's weird. That was not a franchise, but almost every local kid show that I saw had that. New York had one called Wonderama that had that. And that was like, I don't know where that came from. If that was like an old Carney thing or wherever. Probably. It was like, that's what they get,
right,
you know?
Yeah. And so I was actually in the theater taping that show one time.
Oh, you got to go see the taping.
Yeah.
That must have been amazing.
Oh, yeah. My eyes were popping. It was great.
My dad was on an episode, 1964, was on an episode of our local Bozo. And I found it. I found a tape of it, and him and my uncle. And he couldn't believe I brought it to Christmas one year. And it was just like, you could go to a TV show in Florida or wherever, because they were shooting stuff locally, which they don't do now, and kids stuff. And I met a lot of people, I don't know if this was your experience, got into the studio, and they're like, this is really small.
Yeah, you know, you're surprised. You're thinking it's this enormous, luxurious set of cardboard stuff and, you know, just a little room.
Yeah, it's like sort of ruins it a little bit, but it's also probably really exciting.
It didn't ruin it for me. I was still thrilled to be there. And, of course, there was a lot of other kids there with me. So I had a good time.
Was there a cartoon or something that sort of sparked that desire to want to be a cartoonist?
Well, all the Disney stuff. You know, I was really in love with the Disney movies, and of course the Wonderful World of Disney on TV, all of that stuff. But then the Warner Brothers cartoons, Bugs Bunny, all of those, Roadrunner, I just loved all of those things. They were great.
Well, I mean, the great thing about the Looney Tunes and the Disney stuff to a degree, but the Looney Tunes stuff is specifically kind of to the Mad Magazine thing.
Yeah.
Since those weren't made for kids, they were made for adults to be in front of theatrical stuff. They didn't talk down to us, and we also learned all this stuff about show business. Like when I was growing up, there's people doing Jimmy Cagney impersonations, and you know, people, actors that have been dead for 30 years, and kids know who they are because of Looney Tunes, which is completely insane.
And that's the way you should do it.
Yeah,
I don't think you need to talk down to kids and try to make some toilet humor all the time. Intelligent stuff.
I mean, I feel like for all audiences, whenever you make stuff you think they want, it's bad. And when you make stuff that you would like if you were them, that's when you get something good.
Right. As an artist, that's what I was trying to do, just entertain myself with my drawings, do something that I think is interesting, and I figure someone else should also agree with me.
Not yeah.
Everybody. Some people, everybody's different. But if I try to draw what I think I should be drawing to please somebody, that is good.
Yeah, I mean, you don't exist in a vacuum. You have to think if there's one of me that likes this, there's probably 1,000 people like that, at least, who like that. Yeah, of course. It sounds like it. You know, the back to the Westerns, they were the predominant genre in the 50s and 60s, really. Yeah.
Every other show.
Yeah, and everybody loved them. And even in comics, the 50s sort of was huge with Westerns, and then totally gone. Like, I look now and I think things like Walking Dead have kind of met
well,
that.
Sci-fi kind of took over from Westerns, I feel.
Yeah.
Like space Westerns.
Yeah.
You know, so you still had shooting.
Right. Yeah.
You still had this kind of exotic locale, bad guys and good guys.
Yeah, Star Trek's basically a wagon train.
Sure. I think Lucas has pretty much said that.
Yeah. Is that kind of where you learned storytelling? Like, is there a TV show that you feel like may have...
You know, I've given a lot of thought to that. I was never taught storytelling. Even when I got in the business and I was actively trying to get someone, hey, can you explain this to me? I couldn't find anybody to teach me. But I think I learned my storytelling from all the TV shows that I'd watched and the movies that I'd watched. You just absorb that without really trying, I think. So you know when to use a close-up and when to use a long shot and what camera angle might be more interesting just from having seen it so many times.
Yeah, even if you don't know that's what you're picking up.
Right.
Because, you know, I think people probably know the Marvel method, as it was called, which I assume at that time in the 70s they were still kind of doing.
Oh, yeah. Jack Kirby, basically Stan would say, Jack, have the FF fight Galactus this issue.
Yeah.
Go.
Yeah, and then you'd have the... Yeah, and then they'd put in the dialogue later,
yeah.
Right?
You'd have the dialogue on the drawing.
Yeah.
It was the way I like to do it. I preferred that way.
That sounds really difficult, though, especially if you're trying to learn storytelling. They're throwing you into the deep end, and they're like, hey, swim.
Well, that's what happened with me on the New Mutants. Yeah. That was my first regular penciling assignment, and I had not really given that much thought to how I wanted to tell stories visually. And I needed time to think, how do I want to show this scene? And I had no time.
Yeah.
Just throw it right in and started off behind schedule right away because it turned into a graphic novel.
Right.
Which was on a different schedule than the comics. And I just had to draw as fast as I could move the pencil with no time to think. So it was really, I was able to learn on the job in my career.
And I mean, I don't know if this was a detriment or helpful to you, but they were all new characters. So you're trying to draw things fast without reference, really. Like, you kind of had to create the look.
Okay. I didn't have to worry about how Jack Kirby would draw.
Right. Right.
Or Neil Adams or anybody else. I could draw them the way I wanted to draw them.
Right.
So that was actually, I think, in retrospect, probably a really big help.
Yeah, did you create the visual look of those characters mostly on your own, or was because you were Chris Claremont on the
Chris
first?
Chris didn't give me any visual direction. He had all the names and the powers kind of in his head, not nailed down at that point. We still talked about him a little bit, but like 90-95% there maybe.
Mm-hmm.
But he had, you know, left it up to me to say, was Cannonball going to be a big muscular guy?
Right.
Or a scrawny guy, or what? Who was going to be tall or short, or you know, whatever. Sunspot, we were thinking maybe would grow big like the Hulk when he used to.
Oh, that's interesting.
And then we said, well, they've got the Hulk.
Yeah, we don't need that. Yeah.
So, you know, we talked over things like that, and I did some sketches with them looking various ways. And
we'd get those Kirby dots in there.
Yeah. That was not my idea. That might have been Chris's idea.
Okay.
But instead of making him big, let's have Kirby dots. And,
yeah. I mean, it looks like he's crackling. It looks like a powerful thing.
Yeah.
Is it odd to see characters that you've birthed the look of as an artist? And then but comics is unusual, you know, for people that don't follow, I guess, comics religiously, because artists can do their particular spin on a character. It doesn't, especially after the 70s, where people were like, just draw this like Jack Kirby because he drew it first. You know, you could draw that character in a completely different way, almost unrecognizably. Is it strange to see sort of your characters drawn by other people?
Yeah, it's very frustrating, actually, because when I designed them, I designed them to be a person. So I'd be like me talking to you here, and then suddenly I see you tomorrow and you're taller.
Yeah, yeah. I have a mohawk. Yeah.
You just don't look like the same person. Just using your same name, doesn't do it for me.
Yeah.
After I left, suddenly Sunspot was the same height as Cannonball.
Right.
You know, there's supposed to be at least 6 inches difference between their height and things like that. So I'm just sitting there, you know, I don't need to see this.
Because that's built into their... It's built into their personality, because Sunspot's kind of a hothead. He's kind of got short guy syndrome. You know, he's like, it makes sense, you know, and he's constantly sort of arguing with Cannonball. There's a rivalry there, and part of it is built into his size. And yeah, that stuff kind of gets missed. It's strange.
But, you know, comics, I'm not your typical comic artist. A lot of comic artists learn to draw and want to draw these muscular superhero type figures, and that's not where I'm at. You know, I wanted to be more Drucker. I wanted to have individual body types and just more normal people and draw them in a way that looks interesting instead of just have it all be about the muscles.
Right. Well, I mean, they went to fine art anatomy classes, and they feel like they have to get their money's worth, I think, a little bit, because they know how the muscles work, so I might as well make them all look like, you know, that's true. They're like, I don't think you have muscles there. I don't know how that would work.
Smith was so funny in that respect, because he's such an amazing artist. And when he started out, he was influenced by Kirby.
Yeah.
And of course, Kirby stylized his figure so extremely. So when Barry Smith started out, Windsor Smith,
Did you work with him on Conan?
On Conan.
Yeah.
He would have these muscles, and you'd think, what?
Yeah. What does that do exactly?
And then but then shortly after that, you know, obviously he, I guess, studied more anatomy or just got better at the anatomy from drawing Conan. And his drawing is amazing. But it was funny to see an artist that good drawing these weird muscles.
Yeah, you're like, I don't know, it's amazing. But he always did a very good job at drawing very slight characters that still seemed powerful.
Well, you know, I think we tend to draw our own body types, and Barry is kind of slender.
Okay.
Or at least he was. I haven't seen him in a long time.
Yeah.
And I, as a shorter person, I tend to draw shorter figures. I started with Pat Broderick. He was my first roommate in the business.
Right.
And he's kind of tall, and he would draw these tall figures.
Do you think that's a movement thing? Like, you understand how that shape would move? Because
you know, as I draw, and I guess this is true of all of us, I kind of think of myself in that pose as I'm drawing that pose.
Right.
So, yeah, you feel your body as you're drawing the body. So I'm sure it influences you. John Buscema was this big, burly guy, and he drew these big, burly figures.
Certainly did, yeah, absolutely. Was there a book that you wanted to work on that you didn't get to, or you had, that you just really wanted to draw?
I mean, not too much, because what I really wanted to be doing was humor.
Right.
I'm much more inclined toward humor. But for the comics, I never really got into Batman. Did him as a guest star in one of my Superman issues that I drew, and I inked him over Graham Nolan for a couple years, but I never really penciled Batman very much, and I always thought I could have done a decent job on Batman.
Yeah.
But I mean, I got an opportunity to draw so many of the major heroes. I had a very nice career.
Is there a character that you get requests for sketches for the most?
Interestingly, Spider-Man.
Huh.
Now, I don't know if that's because he's such a popular character, or they remember me drawing, because I've done a lot of Spider-Man.
Yeah, you're in a lot of the 200s issue.
I did all kinds of Spider-Man. I did a lot of fill-ins. I was never the regular artist on Spider-Man, but he's probably the one I get the most requests for.
And he's the least traditional body type I can think of from a major character.
Well, it's fun to draw because of that. Maybe, again, because I like humor rather than these stereotypical superheroes.
Yeah.
He gets in these poses that we really can't get into.
Right.
Yeah, so it's more fun to draw him. So I have a good time.
But again, Ditko was so stylized, too. I mean, you know, and I wonder, those guys didn't grow up with comics because they didn't exist. They worked in commercial art or greeting card, you know, so they had to sort of invent this stuff for the first time. So it's interesting to see. I think you're probably of the first generation of kids that got into making comics that grew up reading comics.
Probably. When I got into the business, most of the artists were older, in their 40s or 50s, 60s. There were only a handful of us young guys, Klaus Janssen, myself, Al Milgram's around my age, Jim Starlin. You know, you can count them on one hand, practically.
There were sort of these comic madmen type guys.
And then I was kind of the beginning. Klaus was there a year or two before me. We were kind of the opening of the floodgates.
Yeah.
All these young people came in.
So you were at Marvel when they'd done some 60s shows. There was the Marvel Superheroes and the 68 Spider-Man that Ralph Baschke did. Another great humor cartoonist. But you were there when, like, the Incredible Hulk show started airing and the Saturday morning cartoons started happening. Do you remember any of that sort of bleeding into the Marvel bullpen, or kind of what was?
I don't think so. Not so much. I mean, I watched the Hulk show and enjoyed that. Bill Bixby and Lou Ferrigno. And I don't remember particularly. We just kind of laughed at it because it was a little. That and the Batman show, you know, with Adam West. It was just too campy.
Yeah. Basically. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, the Hulk is basically
we
the fugitive.
To be serious, you know, we were trying to take our comics seriously, and I don't think anybody I know of was really influenced by that so much. And the cartoons, I never really watched those superhero cartoons. I guess I was busy learning my craft, drawing comics. So I never really even saw any of those.
Because you were drawing, I think, Defenders with the Hulk when the Hulk was on. And I, you know, one thing that always amazed me was that there didn't seem to be a conscious effort to make the comic Hulk look like the TV Hulk, despite how popular the show was. Even in the Curtis magazine they did, which was definitely aimed, I guess, at more of a TV viewer audience.
Yeah, maybe.
Where DC would do that.
There was a clear separation between the entertainment movies and TV and comics.
Yeah.
We thought of ourselves as, you know, separate things. And at that time, it wasn't a corporate business. It wasn't that kind of attitude where it was all about the bottom line and all that.
Right.
It was much more people working in the business were there because they liked to draw comics.
Yeah.
Or they liked to draw, period. But it wasn't because they wanted to get rich or famous.
Right.
You know, because you couldn't do it.
Yeah, even though, weirdly, you know, the print runs were a hundredfold what they are now.
Yeah.
But you were still relatively obscure from a popular culture standpoint, even though the volume was way higher than it would be now.
Well, a lot of those were returnable.
That's true. Pre-direct market.
We sold so many copies. Marvel at one point would cancel a book if it sold under 100,000.
Right. And that would be the number one comic on the thing now. Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
there were a handful of publishers. There were maybe five publishers.
Right.
Whereas now there's 5,000.
Yeah. And anyone can kind of publish their own thing. And DC bought a lot of them and incorporated them into their own universe. Because I was still buying, what was the company? Oh, they did a lot of Ghost comics, not Gold Key. Charlton. Charlton,
sure.
Which had a whole superhero run as well, which was Blue Beetle, and I think that DC run. Yeah, I love Charlton. They always Ditko did a lot of stuff for Charlton, I think, in the 80s, which were always strange. Did you get to do any humor stuff? Because even in the 80s, Marvel was doing that.
I kept drawing for Crazy. I did the Teen Hulk.
Oh, yes.
Crazy, and some more satires. A couple other little jobs for Crazy. But other than that, not so much. I never even tried to work for Mad because I thought my style was just too close to Mort Drucker.
Okay.
I didn't want to be copying Mort Drucker while Mort Drucker was still there.
Yeah, they have Mort Drucker. Yeah.
And I couldn't be as good as him or better than him at what he was doing, so I didn't see the point in doing that. So I didn't really pursue my humor interest. I was busy raising a family also,
yeah.
And it became a job rather than my passion so much for when I had little kids.
Yeah.
I just directed my energies in other ways. It's not like I wasn't having fun drawing the superhero comics.
It's still a nice gig, yeah.
So that was fine.
Were your kids into the stuff you were doing? Were they like super excited?
Incredibly no.
Yeah.
I had three kids, and they read my comics when they were little, because I had Marvel and DC used to give me every single thing they published.
Yeah.
And so they had all these comics there for them to read. But my boys, I have a daughter and two sons. My daughter just never had any interest in them, and my sons read them and enjoyed them, but then kind of just lost interest.
It's your dad's job. No, it's the funniest thing. Everyone I know, no matter how amazing and exciting their job is, the only people who are just like, are their kids. They're just like, that's what dad does for work. Not interested. And it's fascinating to me.
Yeah, it was funny. One time I went to my son's high school to do this, Spider-Man night or whatever. They had this big production of the local artist coming to the school, the Spider-Man artist, so I did this big presentation. And my younger son, Andy, finally ended up drew up a little sign and was walking around, "Yes, it's my dad."
Stop asking me if you can meet Spider-Man.
It's totally underwhelmed.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. It's not just you. It's just this weird, maybe it's genetic so that people leave home. Yeah. Some weird thing where they're just like, nothing my parent does can be that cool, no matter what it is. It's very strange. But, you know, in the mid-80s, Marvel started doing Star and a lot of those sort of funny animal stuff, which are really clever. Like, I loved Spider-Ham and, bringing back What the...
I think I would have drawn some of that stuff.
Yeah.
But I was just, my career had taken off doing the superheroes, and I just, for whatever reason, I didn't make a point of seeking that word out.
Yeah.
They didn't, you'd think that they'd offer it to me, but no.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it, I guess. You know, you're getting gigs.
Howard the Duck.
Oh, did you? Okay.
I inked a couple issues of Howard the Duck over Gene Colan and Mike Golden.
Oh, wow.
And that was great fun. Loved working on Howard. Even that, I didn't do regular comic very much. If at all, did I do? I don't.
Was it the magazine? The magazine you worked on? Yeah. I mean, the art in that's fantastic. That was one of the things I loved about the Marvel magazines is the art quality was upped substantially.
I think some of my best jobs were in the magazines, yeah.
In the Howard Duck specifically?
Well,
or Conan? And Hulk? Yep.
I was inking Bill Sienkiewicz. I penciled, inked, and colored a Hulk and lettered a Hulk job in that full-color Hulk magazine. And then the Howard the Duck jobs, I think, are two of my best jobs.
Did you see the Howard the Duck movie?
No, thankfully.
You've never seen it?
I heard it was not too good.
I actually really like it, but it's not the comic. Like, he's not that, you know, he's almost like Mr. Mitzelpitlick a little bit in the comic. You know, he's kind of like a little jerk, yeah. in the best way. And in the movie, it's...
He was kind of a wise guy in the comics, but I don't know anything about the movie.
Yeah, the movie, he's almost just a plot device more than a character, you know? He's missing that personality that he has. What was the thing that drew you to comedy? Like, were there comedy shows you watched as a kid that you just loved, or...?
Well, I watched a lot of comedy shows, but I don't think so. I think it was the newspaper comics. I just really liked, like, Peanuts.
Yeah.
And I used to read all the Harvey line of
Okay.
Uh, Richie Rich.
Hot Stuff.
Hot Stuff.
I love Hot Stuff.
Lulu.
Yeah.
I don't know if that was
that was Harvey, yep.
I just read all those and really enjoyed those. There was one about a father dog and a baby dog.
Yep.
I forget what the name of that one was, and I loved that comic. So I think it was those early Harvey comics probably had a huge influence on me.
Did you ever think about trying to go into animation later, or did you ever meet with...
Yeah, that was my plan. I was going to work for Disney and do animation, and then I got rejected at Marvel.
Yeah. And then the spite kicked in.
I knew this. And then my career took off in comics, and like I said, I got distracted with my family, and I didn't really want to move out to California.
Yeah, you kind of have to go to Caltech to go to work at Disney.
Yeah, so I didn't really pursue that. I was happy in my career.
But your children's book stuff is sort of more in that style,
that's
right?
That's when my career started slowing down.
Right.
In the 2000s, there was a big slump in the industry, and it started getting a little harder. They weren't just automatically throwing jobs at me all the time.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Oh, no problem.
Getting to lose my voice a little bit. So I had always wanted to do a children's book, and my wife had wanted me to do one, and my mother-in-law had wanted me to do one, everybody. And I said, well, now, why don't I try doing a children's book?
Got some time.
And I was thinking about, should I do funny animals? Should I do, like, some dinosaurs or something? What kind of children's book should I do? I wanted to get away from superheroes and do something different. And I just couldn't make up my mind, and so, you know, a couple of weeks went by, and my wife was getting really frustrated that I wasn't turning this children's
book. I asked for a children's book.
She said, you know so much about superheroes, why don't you do a superhero alphabet book?
Yeah.
And, you know, that's a pretty good idea. I don't know why I didn't think of that. That's pretty good.
Why didn't you tell me this earlier?
So that's what I went with, and I had never written anything, but I said, ABC, how hard can it be? I can do this. So I did a few sample pages and wrote ideas for the entire book and sent that off, and just got lucky and got a big publisher. HarperCollins published it. The editor there saw it and had a 5-year-old son. So, my son would love this.
Yeah. And he probably did.
Yeah.
Do you have anyone that goes to the cons that has you sign the book, the children's books, or fans of the children's books? Yeah.
Today somebody came up to me, brought their copy from home, and had me sign it. But I get people coming up to me at the shows all the time. Oh, my kids grew up on that. They love
yeah.
the book. And I sell it at conventions, and I actually sell a lot of copies at cons. I did that back in 2006, 12 years ago, and it's still selling well.
Yeah, and I mean, for a kid, 12 years is a long time. So if they had that when they were 5 or 6 and they're, you know, 18, 19 now, it probably feels like something from their lifetime.
A lot of people come and say, oh, I read that when I was a kid.
And you're like, that was a couple of years ago. How were you? Yeah. It's always odd how time exponentially moves faster as we get older. Where it's like, there's less milestones, I guess, is the big thing that mark our lives.
Time is actually moving faster.
It may be moving faster, yes. I mean, you would know, having worked in superhero comics for so long. Did you the New Mutants movie, did you see any of it, or did you know anything about it? I mean, they were using your characters.
They had not said boo to me about the movie. I don't know any more than the average person.
They shot it here. I knew that.
Yeah. And I thought about trying to come to the set, but I was just busy doing other stuff. And then it got pushed back and pushed back again.
Yeah.
And, you know, a horror movie is not what I would have done.
Right. And it wasn't really the New Mutants you worked on. Later, there were something, like Cinco Witch's stuff probably would
and
translate to that.
The director really was into was Bill's Demon Bear saga.
Yep.
And his later stuff. And I love Bill's work, too.
Very different.
Very different.
Although it's funny that you inked over him when he was probably in his Neil Adams kind of phase.
Exactly,
that was, yeah.
I mean, we're friends. We get along, and I love his art. But at the time, you know, when he took over, fans were shocked.
Yeah.
And a lot of people hated it because it was so different.
I remember as a kid, it was jarring.
Yeah. And then, you know, he won them over.
Yeah.
And I guess a lot of people liked it right away also, but there was a big... It was such a switch, you know, a lot of people... It was too much for a lot of people.
The only thing I could equate it with to people is if you had a Saturday morning cartoon you loved, and one Saturday it was live action.
Yeah.
And it was good, and it was just all of a sudden it's live action. And you're like, wait, this is not the same show.
It is not the same book anymore.
Yeah.
And, you know, New Mutants went through a series of changes. different artists and different looks and different storylines. And you got to give Chris Claremont credit for pulling all that together. But the movie, after I started thinking about it, I said, well, it's actually kind of cool that they're going to do a horror slant to it, because that'll bring in a whole new audience
that
wouldn't necessarily go to a superhero movie. And it could, it's instead of just doing another thing where it's just them fighting themselves at first, and then they fight the bad guys at the end, and the explosions and what have you, this could be actually a different way to enjoy a superhero movie. So I'm excited for it. I think it could be really good. I'm going to stay optimistic.
Yeah, same. I mean, New Mutants is my favorite mutant comic, and when I heard that about the horror piece, I was like, you know what, though? Like, the becoming a mutant is the metaphor of the horrors of adolescence, you know, in addition to the sort of race allegory. And so it's kind of perfect that that would be a horror movie, because, like, puberty is terrifying. And if you have the power to turn into a wolf or something like that, it's, you know, it's horrifying. So that's kind of an interesting take.
Movie, I was a teenage werewolf.
Yes, yeah. Michael Landon, speaking of Westerns, when he did the show Highway to Heaven in the 80s, which was not a show I loved, but they did a Halloween episode called I Was a Middle-Aged Werewolf that he wrote and directed. And it's great. It's great. And he gets in the actual the makeup again. It's amazing. And I don't want you to lose your voice, so I'll wrap up here. But is there anything you collect? Like, are there any artists that you collect their art or that you're just a huge fan of? Or
yeah, you know, I really like the old newspaper strip artists, Hal Foster,
yep.
Alex Raymond, John Prentice, Al Williamson, Leonard Starr, Stan Drake. All of those guys I have hanging in my studio at home on the walls rather than comic artists. I've got Neil Adams up there, but I've got this Ben Casey stuff.
Yeah, yeah. The least dynamic Neil Adams stuff that there is.
I have one little piece by Mort Drucker up there.
What's the Mort Drucker piece of?
He did a little Tarzan paperback.
Oh, okay.
With Marlon Brando as Tarzan.
Oh, that's bizarre.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's really, I loved it. And it's just a page out of that that someone traded to me for something years ago. So
is there anything of yours that you just will not part with? That you're like, this is, I'm keeping this?
Well, I still have my, all the art to a lot of jobs that I penciled and inked.
Okay.
I have all the pages, and I hate to just sell one page out of it.
Yeah.
So I've got those, but, you know, I'm not going to live forever, so I've got to let go of those at some point. I wish that I had hung on to a lot of my art, because I really don't like selling my art. But, you know, it piles up and sits in a drawer.
Yeah, you're doing 24 pages for a bunch of issues, you know. And did they give you the option of taking the pages, or were they just kind of like, we have them for duping and then we just put them somewhere?
Well, in the beginning, in the 60s, they didn't used to give back original artwork. They would give it out to people as a gift if you took a tour of the Marvel office or whatever. Give away Jack Kirby.
It's an original Kirby.
$1,000.
Yeah, yeah.
But in the late 60s, early 70s, Neil Adams saw them about to toss some of his work in the garbage. And he said, I'll take that. Don't do that. And Neil's really the one that got them to start returning artwork. So by the time I got in the business, they were returning our artwork.
It's amazing how, I mean, that wasn't just unique to comics either. They were taping over, you know, Dinosaur Show tapes of original, you know, they were throwing away animation cells. They were just, it was just a product, you know.
Well, and the guys in the older generation thought of it as just process work.
Yeah.
The comic was the finished job. Stan Drake, one of my favorite artists, that did the Heart of Julia Jones newspaper strip, would cut up his original pages and just paste a head of Eve Jones onto a new strip so he wouldn't have to draw it.
So it might have been like 10 times using the same thing after a while, right?
I can't even imagine doing that.
Yeah.
He didn't value his original art, and a lot of the artists of his generation didn't.
It's just a job.
They didn't even want their original art back.
What are they going to do with it?
Who needs that stuff?
Yeah. I mean, because you live in an apartment in New York City. Where are you going to store all that?
Yeah.
I don't want this stuff that I did. I guess to them it would be like if you worked in an office and every spreadsheet you ever did, they're like, here, you want these? And you're like, no, I don't want a box of spreadsheets. What am I going to do with those?
Yeah.
It's crazy. Is there any character that you drew that you later saw adapted into like live action or a television show or anything like that, that you were like, this is interesting? I mean, obviously the Conan movie came out after you did the comics, but that was
the Conan movies. I didn't think Schwarzenegger, I like him as an actor in some of the movies. He didn't do it for me as Conan. I don't know. Usually I didn't like those productions.
Yeah.
I do like most of the superhero movies currently, the Marvel movies. The first Superman movie and the Dark Knight movie.
Okay.
But generally, I don't like DC's movies as much.
You're in the mainstream of thinking there. To me, like DC, like Justice League Unlimited and the animated shows blow anything out of the water that anyone else has ever done. Other than that, I loved Wonder Woman.
Yeah, Wonder Woman was very good. To me, The Incredibles is the perfect superhero movie.
Of course it would be to you. I mean, that's the perfect combination of Disney humor and superheroes.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah, Incredibles, Iron Giant.
Wonder I love that movie. Yeah, Incredibles is basically Kirby Fantastic Four meets the Looney Tunes.
Yeah.
That's like the best way I could. It's perfect. Yeah.
Yeah, the little kid that runs a Dash, is that his name?
Yeah.
And the clothes, the costume designer.
Yeah. Is there anything you would love to see adapted that you think could really work that no one's sort of tapped into yet?
I mean, there's so much. They've got like thousands of characters that can still be made into movies. And maybe they will be eventually. Whoever thought the New Mutants would ever be a movie?
Yeah, that was just the last X book. I mean, maybe Excalibur, I would be surprised of, but I'd love to see that.
There's a series by a friend of mine, June Brigman, Power Pack.
Oh, yeah. I love Power Pack so much.
So why isn't that a movie or a TV show?
That'd be an amazing TV show.
TV show for kids.
Yeah.
And there's talk about it coming out, but for some reason it just hasn't.
They did a pilot in the 90s, and it's awful.
Yeah.
But now it would be fantastic. I mean, that's, you could make that like Stranger Things or Goonies, or it would have that sort of vibe.
It'd be a big
hit. Yeah. And you worked in the era, you know, before the sort of darkening, which is sort of what most of the stuff is drawing from now. I don't think the Marvel movies quite as much.
Yeah.
But was that did you feel a shift from that sort of stuff?
Definitely, and I did not like it.
Yeah, because it's not your style.
All my humor and the lightness. I mean, to me, the Superman books of the 60s were the best ones.
Yeah.
Because they were fun.
Yep.
You know, once you start taking Superman too seriously, he's a god, and, you know, It just takes all the fun out of it.
Yeah.
All this dark. I mean, Dark Knight was okay as Batman because he's a dark character.
Yeah.
But you don't want to make every character dark like Batman.
Yeah.
And you don't want to make every character a smart-ass wise guy, you know, like Deadpool either.
Yeah.
You let them be who they are.
They're characters. Yeah.
Yeah. So once the comics started getting all dark, that's kind of when I started losing interest in them.
Yeah.
So I quit reading comics a little shortly after that, around that time. That just wasn't what I was into.
Yeah. I mean, I was the same way. And I was, you know, I loved comics. And once it started getting that, like, anti-hero, you know, or like, I'm like, Batman's dark, but he doesn't shoot people. What are you doing? You know, I'm 12 and I know that.
And Wolverine, you don't really want to see Wolverine slice someone apart.
Yeah.
I don't.
No, me either. Like, that's, it ruins the sort of heroicness of them. And, and I think there was room for humor. Like, New Mutants had humor in it, in the way that the kids interacted with each other.
That's what I enjoyed the most, is those scenes where they were having fun with
Not doing superhero stuff. You know, it's teenagers.
If I had been writing the book, not to criticize Chris, but if I had been writing the book, I would have kept them in the school longer, had them be teenagers with teenage problems, be the focus of the series, before we ever send them out in space and before we ever have them fighting bad guys or whatever, fighting for their lives.
Because we're already doing that in X-Men.
Yeah. There we go again, but, you know, it's a business.
Yeah.
You got to do what the...
Give the people what they want. Yeah. Is there anything you watch now? Are there any TV shows you love?
You know, I hear about all these superhero TV shows, and I haven't watched any of them. I watched an episode of Jessica Jones. Just couldn't get into
it. It's grim. You might like The Gifted.
Yeah.
The Gifted is essentially New Mutants, but a little more mixed with sort of The Fugitive, and it's a little more akin to the stuff, the mutant stuff you did.
If it's not too dark,
yeah,
maybe I'd like it.
Yeah.
I hear that Supergirl TV series is fun.
Flash is fun.
Flash.
Because the 90s series where they just tried to make Flash Batman, yeah. It's like, no.
Well, you know, my wife's not into this stuff.
Yeah.
So we watch TV together, and the shows we watch are shows that I think we both would enjoy instead of she's just watching because I want to watch it.
Or right.
Just watching it because she wants to watch it. There's not very much of that. So we don't tend to watch those shows, even if I might.
I mean, we were talking before we started recording to sort of go full circle here that, you know, you watch stuff as a family and you're kind of still doing that, it sounds like. But the great thing about that is you get exposed to stuff you wouldn't have necessarily checked out otherwise because somebody else wants to watch it. And I have a theory
Ed Sullivan show.
Yeah.
That was for everybody. I watched all kinds of stuff on Ed Sullivan I would never have chosen to watch.
But probably really enjoyed.
Yeah,
yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, like, you know, you're not going to turn on... I mean, Ed Sullivan's... If you showed a kid a picture of Ed Sullivan, they're going to be like, that looks great.
Well, comics like Don Rickles.
Yep.
You know, that's not what I would have chosen, and yeah. I would laugh at Don Rickles.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's amazing how we sort of missed that sort of thing, but it is always kind of great when you begrudgingly watch something because someone else wants to and then end up really liking it. And I also have a theory that, you know, people pre-millennial generation were better at negotiating because we had to make a case for our show because there was only one TV. No, you really should watch this. It's really good. So we were able to make arguments and compromise.
You couldn't tape it.
Yeah, yeah. So we sort of absorbed those things more. Well, thank you so much for taking the time. I know that the convention is draining and it's the last thing that maybe we want to do is talk after 3 days of doing it, but it's been great to talk to you, and I really appreciate you taking the time.
Thanks.
Thank you. There you go. That was Bob. What a great guy. Super nice guy. Fascinating stories. Anyone who's ever worked with Jack Kirby, I mean, come on. Working in the Marvel bullpen, pasting numbers onto pages, just incredible. Check out his stuff. I will put links up to his webpage on TVGuidanceCounselor.com. Buy his children's books. Just check him out. Commission some art if he's at a convention near you. Just a great guy and one of my favorite artists of the era. If you'd like to email me, you can do so at TVGuidanceCounselor@gmail.com. Ken and I, KenReadCom on social media, TV Guidance Counselor or Ken Reed Comedian on Twitter and Instagram at Kenneth W. Reed or at TV Guidance. Peter, that is very rude of you. I'm going to attend to Pete because he seems to be very upset about a child on a bike or maybe a bird. He's having some issues with the crows in our neighborhood. They are taunting him. And I will be here next week. So we'll hopefully see you then on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.